joy to see all of you here, and especially a welcome to Elise and her entire family. We are so blessed to have you here and see you out and about working again. And there's been a lot of prayer warriors plugging for you all the way. And we hope you and everyone else here today are blessed by this worship service. Are there other announcements that are not printed in the bulletin that need to be made from the floor? Joyce?
There will not be a mother and daughter banquet next Saturday night, but we did order the impatient plants, and they will be given out next Sunday on Mother's Day. So please come out and get your plants. We've ordered about 75.
Good. There is a dedication this afternoon at the old St. Paul's Lutheran Church in Startown. I was in college with Stephen Harrison. He's the author of a book called Faith of Our Fathers Still Live. And it's the history of the church there, built back in 1756. If you have not gone through that church ever, or if you have and would like to reminisce, he and his wife have spent the last 20-some years writing this book, and sadly to say, his wife Laura passed away 2 years ago before the book was completed. But in speaking with him in years past, this was an exciting lifetime project for them. So, can go. It's at 3 o'clock at the old St. Paul's Lutheran Church in Startown. Camelia, you had something to say.
It gives me great pleasure to announce that we will be keeping Pastor Peter and Maddie and Bella all for another year.
Yes. That comes early. And for Wayne and I, we are going to be great grandparents of a little girl. The sad part of that, she's going to be born in Okinawa, and we can't see her, you know, feel her color at the time. But anyway, Ashlyn is real excited, so we are happy for her. So, are there any other announcements? Other announcements? Then let us stand for the invocation. Or basically, know the call to worship, okay? As printed in your bulletin. Rise and greet the morning. Arise, meet the risen Savior. Who encourages our faltering steps,
who splinters us with laughter,
who wrinkles us with compassion,
who raises us to heaven.
Rise now and sing your praise. Amen. Let us pray. O Holy God and Father, help us to remember always that you are King of Kings. Thank you for your love and your holy word and for your gracious love shown in Jesus our Savior. We ask you to bless this worship to reflect our faith in you. We call upon your presence and guidance as we worship you. Amen. Let's remain standing for our opening hymn.
Thank you.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and stood at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. And you may be seated. It is time for us to go to God in prayer. Are there prayer requests, prayer concerns that need to be aired? Joyce? Praises? Joyce?
We pray for Rachel Pallier, which lost Louis Pallier. Pray for the family.
The last name was?
Parlier.
Parlier. Or Harlier.
Parlier.
Okay. Anyone else?
Just pray for our world. It's just a crazy place.
It is. Test of time. Let us, yes, ma'am.
Say praises that we've heard the good news that Pastor Peter and Maddie will be with us. What a wonderful blessing they've been to our congregation and community. I'm so blessed to hear that announcement this morning.
That was Pastor Peter, you don't know how much you are appreciated here. And we thank both of you for being a part of the ministry here at Plateau United Methodist Church in the community. So, let us go to God in prayer. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we worship you and acknowledge that you are the Savior for all of us. We thank you for this congregation and all the families that are represented here today. Help us to learn from all of your creation how to spread the gospel message of peace, joy, and love. Have us to be your witnesses and to put your will above ours, as sometimes we so selfishly desire. Help us to trust your presence within us as we risk doing new things for your and for you. Lord, we lift those who are ill, those who are grieving like the Parliers, those who have serious medical concerns, those who are healing, and those that are recovered and seeking guidance through their work and their play. And Lord, this day, as we have prayed through the months, we do thank you for your healing power on Elise and her family, for your grace that pulled her through the trying times of the tumor. And Lord, we know that you're always there, no matter what happens to us, but we just thank you. We ask you to be with those that are lonely. Lord, bless our country's leaders and our church leaders worldwide. Nudge all of us and nudge our hearts and our minds to follow your direction. Be with our military and law enforcement, with your place of safety and love. Help us, Lord, to always put your will above our own desires. As we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be. trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Yes, the children's story is now, if all the children will come up, we'll have a children's story.
Son of God, who came to cure the sins of the world. Okay? I'm going to stop the story right there, but we're going to come back to it. Now, the other day, I made 3 paper airplanes. This first one's made out of printer paper that you print off from a computer. The second one is a page out of a magazine. This happened to be the TV Guide. They still make them. And then the third one is made out of a dollar bill. Now, somebody said, which one of those would I want to have? I'd say, well, I probably need to look at them first and see how they fly. So let's check them out. We'll do the printer paper first. Watch out, preacher. I'm just going to get that far enough. All right. Not bad. So that one did pretty good. How about this one from a newspaper? From a magazine page. Well, it flew, but not quite as good as the other. Now we've got the dollar bill. Let's see how it flies. That didn't do too good, did it? Yeah. But you know what? This dollar bill made a pretty bad airplane, didn't it, Naomi? It didn't fly very well, but you know what? This before it was an airplane, it was a dollar bill, wasn't it? And if I unfold it, it's still going to be a dollar bill. So this dollar bill, which was a lousy airplane, has worth, doesn't it? Has value. You could take this down to the Dollar General, and with maybe a few more of these, you could get some M&M peanuts, couldn't you? But could you take those 2 airplanes down and get anything at the store? No, you couldn't. They wouldn't give you anything unless they felt sorry for you and gave you something. All right, so keep that in mind as we go back to John and Jesus. Now, John wanted everybody to follow Jesus. He said, Jesus is the Lamb of God who came to save us of our sins. He's a very special and important person. But you know, the people that didn't know Jesus and just saw him there, they didn't think much of him as far as what he looked like. They hadn't heard him preach. They hadn't heard him do miracles. He didn't look like a prince or a king wearing a royal robes or anything. He wasn't high up in the church or in government. His family wasn't very important in the community. So if they had to pick the most important person they knew, they wouldn't have picked Jesus. But you know, Jesus is like this dollar bill. We have to know what Jesus was before he came to earth in human form. And what Jesus was the Son of God, and he lived in heaven. And you know, Elizabeth and Naomi, our life starts at birth when we're born, doesn't it? But Jesus was always there. And he is always going to be there. But Jesus came to earth to show us how to live and how to get to heaven. He sacrificed himself for our sins. So we must always follow Jesus, okay? Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this church and our congregation that gathered today. We thank you for our pastor and his family. We thank you, Lord, that he's going to be with us longer now. Lord, we thank you for these children and all the children in our congregation and communities. We pray that you'll nurture them, that they will grow in the Spirit and always be close to you, Father. Father, we know that these children are precious to you and they are precious to us too. And Lord, we pray these things in the name of your precious Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Amen. Yeah, appreciate y'all being down here. Thank you.
Oh Lord, we lift these gifts to you to understand that everything that we receive and get in this earth all comes from you, our Heavenly Father. We thank you and we ask your blessings on it. Amen. Let us remain standing and sing our next hymn.
James and John, sons of Zebedee,
who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid from now on. You will be catching people." When they had brought their boats into shore, they left everything and followed him. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, be with us during this worship setting. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, our Redeemer. Amen. I titled my sermon today, Fishing Skill. And I really appreciate that first song, Pam. That's one of my favorites. We learned that a long time ago in the choir and such, and it's just one of those special pieces of music. Fishing skill. Some of you fish. Fishing lines of a particular weight and color depend on what species of fish you are angling for. There are hundreds of flies depending on the species. The flies are the artificial bait, you know. It is difficult to see the difference between them, but apparently the fish can. And again, uses different kinds of flies depending on whether one is out to catch bass, salmon, trout, catfish, or carp. Professional fishermen do not go out lollygagging around. Simply, lollygagging is not allowed. They go out to catch just anything, but to catch, really, a particular type of fish most of the time. Jesus' example of fishing is the absolute opposite of what we call angling for one kind of fish. Jesus uses a net and catches a little bit of everything. It's a messy business. These days we worry about the dolphins among our tuna fish because there is some evidence that dolphins are smarter than you and I. But other fish get netted with the tuna. In our gospel today, Jesus cast the net in the Sea of Galilee, there they caught, among the other fish, catfish and eels. And eels, at that time, the culture deemed it unclean. And at the same time, that was a smelly more than a little fishy smell. And so full with them being in the boat, that it threatened to sink the boat. The church has sometimes tried to ignore or even censor the diversity in Christ's net. Diversity is never too far from us. If we don't believe that Jesus fishes with a net and not a rod and reel, just look in the pews around you. At least a few of us in the congregation are small fry, caught in the middle of the net surrounded by larger fish. Some of you are flying fish, flashy performers who show God's glory for all to see. Some of us are old and gray, and have swam the great depths that life has to offer. And then there's others that are catfish, scavenging for God's realm, helping to keep the waters clear. Some of you are eels who dart through a few times a year, afraid to stay here for long. But the dolphins are kind and gentle. They're playful companions. The sardines wonder how to commit to Christ's work when laboring so hard just to avoid being eaten by the others. Some in the church don't ever feel alive enough to qualify as fish right now, so they just kind of throw themselves in kind of like seaweed for flavor. There are turtles. They're shy and slow, but determined. And yes, a few of us are sharks, darting around, scaring the others. The community will have to decide whether to throw us out of the church as an endangered species that adds a certain excitement to the mix. Yes, fishing with the net makes for a wonderful mess. The fifth chapter of Luke is telling us that evangelism done with the net, that evangelism done with the fishing net of Jesus does indeed interrupt the status quo. You end up with this mess of fish. You have no idea what you will do with all of them. There is not enough help to bring them in the boats, and the boat is in danger of sinking. Today, some high schools have 65 different countries represented in their student body. Think of that. That's just one kind of diversity we risk by net fishing. Angling fishing is comfortable, but it is not the mixed catch that the body of Christ is intended to be. Church won't add should be seeking wise elders, single parents, alienated church people, and sinners of all kinds, giving baptism in the net of Christ's redeeming grace and love. That's a mouthful. Christ's redeeming love and grace. In addition to evangelism, the scripture describes discipleship. The net should show the disciples are caught in the net too. The fact that they are caught on the holding end of the net is beside the point. They are just as caught in Christ's net as the others. Jesus calls them the way God has called people to throughout history, in their daily life and their daily work. God called Paul through Paul's work, persecuting Christians under the Jewish law. And God calls Peter, James, and John as they are cleaning and mending nets after an unsuccessful night of fishing. What does Peter have that God can use? A boat to preach from, nets for a miracle, and discipline of hard work. Think on that. Boat, net for a miracle, and discipline of hard work. A habit of hopefulness gained from fishing, an occupation where there are good days and some gosh-awful days, and it's not always skill that makes the difference. All of these make Peter's daily life become important to his following Christ. Do not be afraid. From now on, you're going to work for me. Do not be afraid. From now on, you're going to work for me. Can you imagine that? Our daily lives can flow into our discipleship too. How we start the day makes a difference. How we start each day makes a difference. There's a story about an airline passenger who had to go on a long business trip. He rode a shuttle bus from the car parking lot to the airport. After the bus was loaded, the bus driver's mellow, joyful voice came over the loudspeaker. "Welcome to the Sunrise Special. It will be my privilege to drive you safely to your airline destination, and I hope you will enjoy seeing dawn at the water's edge along the way." That greeting to a group of strangers changed the man's whole week. She's not working for the airport. She's working for the building up of the community of God. So do you, and so do I. With such a great catch of fish, all hands are needed. The disciples must be as diverse as the catch. Each one of us has something God wants to use. If not a boat or a bus, then maybe it's a computer, or an oven, a drafting board, a bank account, a wrench, a broom, a paintbrush, or a music instrument. So on and so on with the talents and things that all of us can do. Or perhaps God really needs the attitudes and habits we have cultured through our daily lives and work. Our quality of patience, is it cunning or is it compassionate? A tolerance for noise? Are we one who is able to do many things at one time with everything else going on around us? This great catch is not described as a miracle, but Peter sees and feels in Jesus' guidance a more than human power, and he responds by personal self-judgment. Peter, James, and John were told, "Do not be afraid. Henceforth, you will be catching men." When the boats were brought to land, they left everything, yes, a full boat of fish, and followed Jesus, so the scripture tells us. Peter, remember, had had a bad day before. He was washing his nets, and Jesus tells him to push the boat into the water. Tells him he's going to preach. Peter's exhausted. This is his livelihood, his income. When Jesus finished preaching, he told Peter to put the nets into the deep in the middle of the lake, away from the crowds of people. You know, Jesus is taking him away from the noise. Isolation is often a place of preparation. Isolation is often the place of preparation. The place where we meet Jesus, or where he takes us deeper into relationship with him. Jesus directs Peter to put the nets down. Peter could have said, "Don't tell me how to do my job. I've done this all my life. I'll just quit now." Peter didn't do that. He responded, "I will let the nets down," or better said, "if you say so." At that moment, God led Peter to discipleship. And Jesus knew how the church would be made up of people from all cultures, vocations, and talents in life. There was a man named Charlie Taylor back in the late 1800s and early 1900s who was a man I would consider just a nobody in school. No one ever recognized him for anything. Very intelligent young man, but never received any honors or any gratitude for anything. Just did his thing as a student and went on. Except at the age of 12 years old, Charlie Taylor decides to quit school and went to work for the Nebraska State Journal. After a few years of working for that company, they had witnessed his intelligence and his skill and his dedication, and they came to him and said, "We're going to promote you to the bindery department," because they were seeing that he had an extremely strong mechanical and engineering mind. You might call it one of those self-trained, self-schooled persons. And they knew he had the talent pretty much to do anything in their company. He worked for a large number of years for them, But while he was there, there were two men who had researched him and came to him, recruited Charlie. Wilbur and Orville Wright gave Charlie the task of developing a lightweight engine that was powerful enough to actually fly. Charlie Taylor designed that engine that flew on December the 17th, 1903, 120 feet in the air with a real steering device. Charlie Taylor's relationship with Orville and Wilbur changed the course of history. It is the variety of skill and the diversity of talents that form the church. Place yourself in the net of Christ to work for his kingdom. This very week, God will interrupt our daily routine to call us again and again and again and again to discipleship. Let us not be afraid. From now on, let's work for the one who cast a wide net and has caught us all. Are we casting a rod in reel, or are we casting a net? Amen. I'll now turn the service over to Pastor Peter.
Thank you very much, Loiselle, for that awesome message. And thank you for giving me a break. We come this morning to celebrate at the Lord's table. A meal that we all should cherish. So Christ our Lord invites us to his table, all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us now confess our sin before God and one another. Together, merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's now just take a few moments in silence to recall those areas in our life where we fall short. Take heart, dear friends, and hear the good news that Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. In his name, and for all he's done, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Right to give our thanks and praise.
That's what you get for taking a week off. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, We praise your name and join now in their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are for your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. Gave thanks to you. He broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. And whenever you do this, do it in remembrance of me." And when supper was over, he took the cup and he gave thanks to you, Father, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you do this, do it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. As we now proclaim the mystery of our faith, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here this morning and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we have the opportunity to feast at his heavenly banquet. For it's through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray the prayer that Jesus gave to us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Come now and be blessed. Thank you.
What a gift. So let us rejoice and be thankful.
All of you peace. Amen.